Welcome to Impossible Objects here at Productronica. Delighted to be joined by Don Migley and Nate
Bodie.
There we go. So welcome, gentlemen. Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, you're known for making all sorts of different fixtures, really. You started out when we first met you for doing fixtures for, stencils and all sorts of different things in the electronics process. So explain to us a little bit about what are the key features that you bring to the fixturing business and your manufacturing process.
Certainly. Well, one of the key learnings initially was just the quality of the material set. Didn't check all the boxes that the assemblers needed. Mm-hmm. Thermal deflection. Did we have 300 degrees Celsius, which they needed for their processes?
Yep.
Can we hit the mechanical tolerances or the properties that they needed? Yes. Do we have an ESD compliant material?
Yep.
All critical. So once we were able to check those boxes, mm-hmm. then we were really able to unlock the freedom that additive manufacturing provides.
Okay.
Ease of iteration, fast turnarounds, a material set that's incredibly lightweight. Mm-hmm. And learning from our customers has been fantastic.
Mm-hmm.
They come back and tell us things that we believe to be an advantage, but they give you the bigger picture as to what it's meant to their business.
Right.
Lightweight. Where operator experience has been phenomenal, who may be handling these tools and fixtures and boards hour on hour, hour after hour after hour.
Mm-hmm.
De-risking conveyors.
Mm-hmm.
You know, less stress and wear and tear on a critical pieces of their operation.
Because it's less weight.
Yeah, it's probably half the weight of the traditional materials they have.
Right.
So initially started as a bit of a me too.
Mm-hmm.
Can our material sets perform and do the things that the materials they're used to can? But then it's just expanded tremendously from there.
Right.
In unlocking that process engineer's creativity.
Mind. Yes. Okay, so let's talk about the materials themselves, first of all. You're using, is it a glass weave that you're using in the process? What do the material sets comprise of?
So right now we use carbon fiber PEEK for mm-hmm. most of the work that we do in the electronics industry. We also can do fiberglass PEEK, mm-hmm. fiberglass nylon.
Yeah.
That'd be, obviously that's insulative, so mm-hmm. that wouldn't have the ESD compliance.
Yes.
But for most of our applications, though, the fiberglass PEEK has been, it's stiff, it's strong, it's lightweight, and it has that ESD compliance that most of our customers want.
Okay. Now, your manufacturing process is remarkably quick. I mean, you can see, there's actually a picture of a machine behind you there. Explain to us a little bit about what happens at each stage on that manufacturing process.
So, sure. So, here what you have is a big roll of basically carbon fiber paper.
Mm-hmm.
And what's going to happen is that carbon fiber paper goes in into the printer. And basically in this module right here, this is a module that's basically just going to tension, get it moving at the right speed, get everything at the, get the forces in the right place and directions and the such. And when you get here to this area, it'll print. It basically puts on just a little bit of water, exactly where you want to put the polymer.
Okay.
It's going to put a water-like substance,
mm-hmm.
In picoliter-sized droplets.
Droplets, yeah.
Onto this carbon fiber paper. And then, which can also be fiberglass, just going back to that point, but for the context of here, we'll just say carbon fiber. And then over here, what's going to happen is that we're going to dump polymer powder, in this case PEEK, onto it. We're literally just dumping the powder on top. And that powder sticks exactly where that water is.
Right.
And wherever the water isn't, the powder is loose. And so you come out and you end up in a vacuum process right here that just vacuums out off all that loose powder.
Loose powder.
So now what you have is basically this carbon fiber paper with the with polymer, this PEEK polymer powder, mm-hmm. exactly where you want it for a given layer.
Right.
And then you bring it through over here. It gets cut into sheets. So you basically, pages. So it's mm-hmm. taking this long roll and you're cutting it into pages. And then over here, it's going to get stacked into a stack. And that stack is then going to get passed. So you end up with this, basically each sheet is a layer of your build block.
Yeah.
And it's stacked with 100 to 150 micron resolution.
Resolution.
layer by layer, and then that basically is going to go into a heat press. So that heat press takes the temperature above the polymer's melting temperature.
Yeah.
And then you squeeze it down while all that powder is melted. And when you squeeze it down, that powder or the polymer basically infiltrates all of the different fibers of your carbon fiber. You end up with a true composite. So this is it's not a sandwich where you end up with carbon fiber, polymer.
Yes.
But it's rather carbon fiber layers with polymer connecting all the way through
the
part.
Through it. Yeah. Permeating through it.
Yep.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then you basically sandblast off the loose fiber.
Fiber. Yeah. I mean, it's an amazingly fast process as well.
Yeah. So because of the fact that it has the inkjet process is it's the rate limiting piece here.
Mm-hmm.
This is all being done at room temperature. And that means that basically we can go as fast as the inkjet printer can print. But inkjet printers are wildly fast.
Right.
They're wildly fast. So we can pump through this sheet at 25 linear feet a minute.
Mm-hmm. Wow.
And so that's part of where we get this incredible speed. So
yes.
It allows us to be able to make something this large at a throughput of about one every 3 minutes.
Wow.
And for these pallets, for a pallet this size?
Yeah, a pallet this size with our current process would have roughly taken about an hour 15 to print.
Mm-hmm.
Now, for carbon fiber peak 3D printing, that's incredibly fast.
Yes.
With this machine, this pallet's 4 to 5 minutes.
4 to 5 minutes?
4 to 5 minutes.
Wow.
And I always have to do this little prop as it really kind of highlights the speed difference. The fastest technologies in additive manufacturing that exist today.
Yeah.
So the fastest probably gets you 180 of these in an 8-hour shift.
Mm-hmm.
We're closer to about 3,000.
Jeez. Wow.
So it's an order of magnitude. We're 20% faster.
That's really changing the paradigm a bit, isn't it, of 3D printing. It's amazing. And I'm also looking at some of the other examples you've got here, and some of them are fairly complex. I mean, you've got a drone here, if we can just hold that up. Obviously you have to process each of these parts individually,
right.
and then put it together. But
everything other than the electronics you see was 3D printed.
3D printed.
Yep.
And you know, again, design features that you could not achieve with other processes.
Yes.
That allow it to be incredibly rigid, durable, and in this space, lightweight being absolutely critical.
Right.
And to that point, actually, I'm going to make a point, like, relevant in the electronics industry are even little things like wiring clips and connectors if you want to make in relatively small volumes, are incredibly expensive to do.
Right.
But for us, they're wildly inexpensive.
Mm-hmm.
So mixing something like this with even the organic shapes of a small drone like this where you have organic structures that you just can't make with standard manufacturing.
Yeah.
When somebody mixes the ability to do things like this with the ability to make things like this, I actually think there's going to be a major unlock.
Absolutely. And I know that you're also working on some other projects as well, potentially using nanomaterials and things like that as well. So that's going to open up another bunch of doors for you.
For sure.
Absolutely, yeah.
The process allows for less restrictions as it relates to material sets, which has been another gating item for additive.
Yeah.
But if you look at the way this process is performed, the material set combinations in the future have far greater potential than other processes.
Yes.
And even something very simple, we do flat and large very well. Which in this space is critical.
Yep.
But we just don't have the thermal tensions. We don't have the layer by layer. Again, this is ambient temperature until we go into that heated press.
Yes.
Opening up a great deal of potential for the future.
Right. Well, that's where your nanomaterials might come in for the thermal excursions and you've already got ESD built into this, but it would help it as well, I guess.
Yeah, well... Yeah. To that point, one of the things that we're constantly focusing on right now is how do we use the fiberglass, which also offers the stiffness, it offers the strength. It's not quite as light, but it's not that much heavier.
Yeah.
But if we can use those nanomaterials inexpensively in combination with that fiberglass it would bring the floor out of the cost of the materials.
Yes.
It would make a significant impact for our end customers.
Yeah. Well, you know, it, on the face of it, it sounds like a fairly simple system and set of products, but when you actually get into it, there's a lot to it. And it's very impressive. Yeah, so congratulations, chaps. It's I'm suitably impressed for this. This is very interesting. So thank you for showing it to us today. And what do you think? What is your next step with it in terms of evolution? Is it to work more on the nanomaterial sets, or have you got some other? You want to improve the manufacturing system. What is the next step?
It's all of the above. Right now, we are actually just starting to sell the high-speed machine, so mm-hmm. that's one of the things that we're pushing on.
Okay.
So
you're selling the machine then,
yes.
as well. I thought you were actually just doing working as a service industry in the process.
We do both.
Okay.
And it's one of the big pieces that we're pushing on is that.
Mm.
We are also at the same time pushing on how do we drive down our material pricing, mm-hmm. which is through these nanomaterials. That's
right.
one of the things that we're doing there. And one of the things that we want to see more of is just how can we use the 3D printing capability here to do things that you just can't do with traditional manufacturing.
Yes. Yeah.
So
yeah.
I think that's...
Yeah. One of my favorite things to do is walk the manufacturing floor at the process engineering level
mm-hmm.
and say to them, look around.
Yeah.
You know, in a dream world, what was something you would have loved to have had a tool or a fixture for that was prohibitive in the past? And
yes.
let's talk about the reasons it was prohibitive.
Mm-hmm.
And very quickly, you see these light bulbs go on and the wheels turn. And they're coming to us with ideas that, for whatever given reason, and we explore those, were prohibitive in the past and unlock their creativity.
Yeah.
And create solutions that they hadn't achieved in the past for a myriad of reasons.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, it's a wonderful process, and you know, I really do want to thank you both for showing it to us today.
Thanks so much for the time, Trevor. It's always great to see you.
Thank you.
Pleasure.
Without reliability. With reliability. A world of difference. Welcome on the journey to better reliability outcomes.